And next we have Reverend Kelli Cruz. She grew up in Shreveport, Louisiana, and attended a church that focused on God's love for all people. Embracing that message, Kelli felt called to the ministry and completed Divinity School at Texas Christian University. Kelli is currently the pastor at Bethany Christian Church in Tulsa. Reverend Kelli Cruz, thank you for joining us this Saturday afternoon.
Hi. Hi, everyone. I'm used to using Zoom on Sunday mornings with my beloved community, Bethany, and this is a little bit different because I don't see anybody's face right now. And so I'm just going to talk to me and let you know a little bit about myself. And I have no idea what other people might expect. Thanks, Margaret. Love you. Margaret is a member at Bethany. I don't know what people might expect in hearing about religious freedom, but I am going to give you a bit of me and how I function in terms of religious freedom and what it means. Through this, I'm going to be referencing some books, and I, on the screen, there's a tiny URL, and then if I can get back to the chat, I will drop that in the chat. So I do need to tell you a little bit more about myself. My undergraduate degree is in religion, and it's a historical critical approach to religion. And with the sprinkling of Christianity. And then I have a professional 3-year degree called a Master's of Divinity, where I did just study Christianity and Jesus and Bible and pastoral care and all of those things. I've spent 20 years in ministry and 9 years here at Bethany. And the most shaping element of my training has been not seminary and not my college training and not even the weeks upon weeks I spent at church camp, as many young church people do. It is the training that I have received through broad-based community organizing networks, specifically Gamaliel and the Industrial Areas Foundation. It was in that context that I was able to clearly formulate and understand a philosophy around what it means to have religious freedom and act on religious freedom. Having and acting on are a couple different things, frankly. And acting on takes a variety of expressions. And so I want to let you know that I am not going to try to serve as an apologist for any origin stories of our country. And maybe it's just the general nerd in me, but there are origin stories. And there's one great introduction to one of the origin stories is Forest Church, So Help Me God. The founding fathers in the first great battle over church and state. While I have a minor in history, I will not be delving into history. I'm not going to talk about how our nation was founded outside of a Christian paradigm. I'm not going to talk about how patriotism is confused with faithfulness in this country. If you need to be convinced that we are not a Christian country, just read about the slave trade. And if that doesn't convince you, then I don't believe anything will. So, what I want to focus on in talking about religious freedom is explore the intersection of organizing theory, a sociological approach to religion, and my deep theological belief that Jesus did not die for my personal sins. but for the healing of all places of sin within my heart, between others with whom I'm in relationship, and the structures and institutions of our world. What I share after this will hopefully give you a little bit of an understanding of what I mean by that, because the overarching message of Western Christianity, whether it is in Europe or in particular America, is that Jesus died for my sins. I reject that notion as a foundational idea of Christianity, and but that's for a different lecture. How we live out our religious freedoms is based on two specific philosophical perspectives. And let's see if I can pull this up. It's where we stand on two spectrums. Where our allegiance lies, I'm not sure which one is the right one there. Do we align ourselves and understand ourselves and work towards an idea of what it means to be human that is about individual persons or the human collective? All of us are functioning on some place in that spectrum. And in Christian theology, we often will bring spectrum ends together and understand them circularly. So if that helps, feel free to use that imagery. I don't believe that as Americans, we have a public idea about what it means to have allegiance to the human collective over and above the allegiance to our individual selves or persons. I think we often see memes shared on social media that are appropriations of other ideas. You can see sometimes the idea of the public good, but this still always comes explained in terms of an allegiance towards the self rather than allegiance to the human collective. In Judaism, and unfortunately in much of Christianity, we do not focus on this, but Jesus was a Jew. So I rely heavily on the idea of tikkun olam, which is the healing of the world, the repairing of the world. Or maybe you've seen the idea of Ubuntu, which on most memes has the definition of I am because you are. But even that definition is problematic and coming through the Western white sieve of ideas, because a truer definition of that word is people are people because of people. Even the defining of the idea is rooted in a collective understanding of what it means to be human rather than an individual understanding of what it means to be human. I don't have access. I'm not the best at this. Let me see if somebody yell at me if you have a question, or feel free to yell at me later if you're offended by my theology. So the other spectrum that we're on, that I believe informs significantly how we understand religious freedom, is do we have a focus or an allegiance on the ends or to the means by which we live our lives? So many Christian communities, to use a phrase that I love, are so heavenly bound that they are no earthly good. And their allegiance is about the ends, whether it's heaven or the purity of behaviors, rather than the ways in which we treat each other or the ways in which we live out our faith, which is the means. But I think across spectrums, we can become obsessed with purity, the purity of individual actions to get to heaven, the purity of society in order to get to heaven, or the purity of process as a means of creating meaning. My idea of religious freedom is taking these two spectrums and figuring out where we are most of the time on that, and then how it is that we are going to live out our religious faith in a public capacity. There are many religious communities, and specifically Christian communities, that do not believe that function in a kind of escapist route. And I don't mean that pejoratively, I mean that sociologically, like they go and they leave the greater society in order to keep, to create a more perfect community. But what I'm talking about is not that, it is that we are to express our religious freedom in this country takes on a public policy expression that that for many people is centered on individual persons and individual actions and the purity of individuals. My focus is much more towards the human collective and hoping and working for creating policy that creates moments of tikkun olam, of repairing of the world, right here, right now. That has a theological name for the Christian tradition. It's called realized eschatology. But most of the time I don't talk about working on public policy issues in order to create a realized eschatology of God's reign on earth. But that's the bottom line of my theological understanding of what it means to have religious freedom and then to act on it. The majority of my experience of acting on my religious freedom in order to do public policy work that is not about individual behaviors and purity, but about creating policy that does something that makes people's lives better, like is rooted in what we do with action. Allied communities of Tulsa inspiring our neighborhoods. I see Scott Carter says liberation theology. I've got Oscar Romero's The Violence of Love as one of my books. I would hope that over time someone would see in my preaching an intersection of liberation theology, womanist theology, and good old-fashioned Saul Alinsky public organizing. In that organizing, people do not gain skill, like people have to be introduced to the skills of working on public policy in the same way that we all have an inclination towards talking and learning sounds as infants. My daughter is six, and you know, she understands that things don't feel right or that something is not fair, but she has to have the gift of language around explaining the variety of emotions. I'm in my office, I have all these random things, of what she's feeling. This is a feelings wheel. But we have to give each other the language to talk about what we believe in and how to accomplish it and give each other the skill sets to do that. And that's what we do with action, is we equip people with the opportunity to tell the stories of their lives using a tool we call house meetings. We do the very important work of identifying leaders who are angry. We have a deep belief that anger is required to get things done, but we have to learn about how to channel that anger in a way that that accomplishes the work and and embraces that emotions and where we are just a part of what it means to be human. We research issues. We are a network of institutions. So broad-based community organizing, you can just search that phrase, is rooted in connecting institutions who have a committed theology, or oftentimes unions will join broad-based community organizing groups, but they have a committed philosophy about how they do their work and what they're committed to. And we provide people with leadership training to work on public policy to make their lives better. I don't know how much, Erica, can you tell me how much time I have?
Well, it's 4 o'clock, so how much more do you have, Kelly?
I will just go through some of the books that I, there's the book list link. I'm gonna go through and then tell you a little bit of why I'm recommending these if you wanna gain more insight into understanding the function of religion in our society, and the sociological element of how religion often controls people into doing things as individuals rather than works for the healing of the world. So one of the important books to help us think about gaining reflection about structures, and this one is about religion, but is Peter Berger's The Sacred Canopy. He was a sociologist of religion and understood that the systems and the structures of religion and society in general function outside of whether or not we have a grasp on the holy, and how we organize ourselves as religious people actually tells us more about what we value and who we understand God to be than our words. There's a phrase that I that could inform Peter Berger's work is that the method in which we do things reveals our identity. And that goes back to that spectrum of ends versus means. Actually, my brother's a PhD in religion, and he and my sister-in-law, Monica Miller, also a PhD in religion, wrote a book called Method as Identity. And it helps think about the processes that we take informing who we are more than what we say we are. And if you'd like to read some introductions to this radical idea that being a Christian and believing in exercising our religious freedom is not just about who people have sex with and if they have babies, then you could also read Oscar Romero's The Violence of Love, A Strange Freedom, which is a compilation of Howard Thurman's books, and others. That's what I've got. I don't know if anybody has questions. I can speak specifically about ACTION as an organization in Tulsa, or I could bore you with more ideas about religion. So.